Welcome to SGNP. Sit back for the next few minutes and hear stories heard nowhere else, on radio, in a magazine, or on the internet. We're the audible voice of gospel music. Our sole purpose at SGNP is to inspire, edify, encourage, and entertain. Now, here's our host, Darren Sutherland, and his partner, Southern Gospel Music Association president and lead singer for Dolly Parton's own quartet, The Kingdom Heirs, Arthur Rice. What's wrong with living right anyway?
Once again to SGNP, Darren Sutherland and my co-host. He's back from his cruise to the Caribbean, Bahamas, or wherever you went, Arthur Rice. Arthur, how you doing, my friend?
Hey, doing great, doing great. Always great to be home. No matter where you go, it's always great to be home, be back home.
Let's take a quick break here from our buddies at Tocoa Falls College. We're going to come back, hear from Jeff Turner as we talk about the best pianist ever in the history of gospel music today and other forms of music. Well, you'll hear a little bit of it. You heard the little intro, little Floyd Kramer as we introed the show today, Music Box Dancer. But you're going to have some great gospel music and some other things. Jeff Turner is going to be with us. And then our special guest this afternoon, Jeff Stice. You know Jeff, great pianist in his own rights, played with a lot of different folks through the years. And he's going to be our special guest right here on SGNP.
Tocoa Falls College in Tocoa Falls, Georgia. Since 1907, TFC, glorifying God through seeking and developing leaders who will impact the world for Jesus Christ. More information on TFC, call 706-886-7299 or visit them online at tfc.edu. That's tfc.edu.
Now, Here's our announcer.
And that's the statesman's leader.
What's that name?
Hobie Lister.
And thy crisper, flakier cracker, boys. What's that name?
Premium Saltine.
Ah, you said it, so let's sing it now.
They're better baked and better wrapped.
Premium Saltine.
Nabisco's crackers in the inner sealed pack.
Premium Saltine.
With soup or salad or for a snack.
Premium Saltine.
Nabisco's crackers in the inner sealed pack.
Premium Saltine.
And when you hear the Statesman's music, you know Jeff Turner's coming up. Jeff Arthur. Jeff, up in St. Louis, Missouri, don't have a lot of time today, so I'm not going to ask you about the weather. I'm not going to ask you if the Rams are going to win the Super Bowl this weekend, because since they left St. Louis, we know you're not a fan, so you're pulling for the Patriots. Arthur, I didn't ask you who was going to win the Super Bowl. Who do you think's going to win, Arthur?
You know, I don't know. I'm pulling for the Jets, you know, all the time. So, you know, I really don't care.
Well, you know what? I'm going to say the Rams because I'm a Todd Gurley fan and Georgia Bulldog. But we're not here to talk about football today, even though it is the Super Bowl. Let's talk about gospel music pianist. And we stirred it up a little bit on the websites and on Facebook and on social media this week, Jeff, on who the greatest of all time was and who are some of the greatest, the five best of all time. I threw it out there to a lot of different formats and got a lot of different answers. And there's answers all over the book. I mean, from great guys like Larry Goss, great guys like Hovey Lister, great guys like Henry Slaughter, Eva Mae Lefevre, Roger Bennett. Jeff, who are we missing out on? Who's some of this one, the names that we don't know? We'll come back in just a second after the break and get your top five. But who's some great ones out there that
How about Leroy Abernathy?
No doubt. Can't do it without Leroy.
Here's one from the beginning, Dwight Brock, who played for the Stamps Quartet and the Vaughn Quartet in the 20s. And he was the first pianist responsible for turnarounds in a song. Before
wow.
then, they'd just sing the song straight. And Dwight was responsible for that. He was also Mom Spear's brother.
Wow.
So...
Wow, did you know that, Arthur?
No, I didn't know that.
Man, Jeff knows everything. How about this name here, Jeff? I dug this one up. Hilton Griswold.
Hilton Griswold, yeah, Blackwood Brothers. Very popular pianist. He did those down runs on the piano very well, and that's what he was popular for back in the 40s and early 50s.
Arthur, do you know Hilton?
No. I didn't.
He's making us look bad, isn't he, Arthur? Arthur, throw a name out there and see if you can get Jeff.
Lord, a name. Nobody I can really throw out there.
If I didn't have it on paper right here, guys, I couldn't do it either. Here's one for you. Wallace Milligan.
Serenaders.
Wow.
Serenaders Quartet, Lumberton, North Carolina. McCrae Dove knows him well. He's McCrae Dove's mentor.
Yeah. Wow.
So he could talk well about Wallace Milligan.
He also played for the Blackwoods in 1939. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Last one I'll try to get you with, okay? How about Joe Roper?
I can never be lonely, Lordy. I know the wondrous word.
I can never be lonely, Lordy. I know the wondrous word.
Oh, the Lord is taking your measurements. And if you stand up tall, oh, you will all be eligible to sit in the heavenly hall.
And you listen to the music and the beautiful singing. And you listen to the wondrous word of the Lord.
I can never be
Yes. Started with the Blackwood Brothers in the late 30s, I think 39, and then went on to play with the Stamps Melody Boys, and then the Stamps Quartet in the 60s.
You know,
yep.
Let's move to some contemporaries and see if we can get you with any of those. How about Channing Ellington?
Gold City. Well, Poet Voices first.
Yeah.
Then Gold City. Mm-hmm. Yep.
We can't get him, Arthur.
Can't get him.
Can't get him at all. Hey, we're going to take a break. We're going to come right back here. We're going to talk top five pianists of all time. Each of you are going to give us our three, and I think you'll like it. But let's hear something from MyPillow on SGNP.
Once again, I want to stop for just a moment and thank my friend Mike Lindell and the fine folks over at MyPillow and MyPillow.com. You know, when we started this show last April, MyPillow was one of the first sponsors to jump on board. And since, I guess, May, I've been sleeping on a MyPillow. And tell you the truth, I sleep rather well. My wife looks at me sometimes and she tries to steal my pillow from MyPillow. And I try to steal her pillow from MyPillow, and we just make a mess of things. I'm sure that happens in your house too. Well, whether you're married, you're single, you're going to love MyPillow no matter where you sleep or who you sleep with. You're just going to love MyPillow. So right now they got a 4-pack special that they're offering with free shipping and a money-back guarantee through March of 2019. That's right, a money-back guarantee through March of 2019. Give them a call today, 1-800-544-8939, 1-800-544-8939. How much is your sleep at night worth to you? They'll advise you on what kind to buy based on what your weight, your bed size, do you use a feather pillow, whatever kind of pillow you use, their sleep experts can help you. 1-800-544-8939. They know how to make it work and make it work well. And always when you call, use that special offer code SGNP. Make sure you use that offer code so we can get credit for it and they'll know where you came from. You know, recently I started working out a lot and I went to a specialty running store to help me find some good shoes because the shoes I had were hurting my feet. Quite frankly, folks, if you're having trouble sleeping, MyPillow is the folks you need to call. Once again, 1-800-544-8939. Free shipping and a money-back guarantee through March of 2019. Always use the code SGNP or go online to MyPillow.com. MyPillow.com, but just use that code SGNP. And hey, thanks for being a part of SGNP, MyPillow.
And welcome back to SGNP, Darren Sutherland. As you know, the historian Jeff Turner, if you listen to us from the start, man alive, Jeff knows everything about gospel music. And my co-host, SGMA President Arthur Rice, Kingdom Air's lead singer. Arthur, we're going to go over our top five. I'm going to give you guys my top five first. That I'm most important, and I know I'm always supposed to do the co-host first, but I don't want to put the pressure on you guys by naming folks that, you know, maybe you forgot or something like that. Is that fair enough? And, of course, Jeff, you span the ages and know everybody that's in gospel music, so people want to hear you, by the way. And if you want to find more out about Jeff and Southern Gospel Memories and Pictures, go to his Facebook page, Southern Gospel Memories and Pictures, and find out there. You can always go to SGNP's Facebook page, our website, SGNP. You can download this episode and so many others, but get them from there. Here are my top five of all time. Starting off, number five. You want me to start from the bottom or the top? 1 through 5 or 5 through 1? Where do you want to go?
5 to 1.
5 to 1. All right. Number five, Jimmy Swaggart.
Well, here among the shadows, living in a lonely land. Well, we're a band of pilgrims on the moon. Oh, burdened down with sorrow, shunned on every hand. And we're looking for that city built on above.
Oh yes, I'm looking for a city where we'll never die. Yeah.
Let me tell you why I think Swaggart's there. Okay, and here's how I define my top five guys. If you brought something different to the industry and a flair to your playing and a professionalism to your play, okay?
Yeah.
During Jimmy's heyday, before the trouble, and you know what? We've all been in trouble, so let's just move past that for just a second and think about the early to mid-'80s, Arthur and Jeff. Jimmy could captivate a crowd better than anyone on stage in the world preaching the gospel, and he did it with a gospel music piano. Is that fair?
Oh, yeah. Sure. I will even go farther than that. In the 70s, you know, I used to watch him every Sunday morning.
Yeah.
And loved it, you know, because, he sang Southern gospel and most of the time and played and had a great band, and it was good stuff.
Number four. Best MC that ever sat on a piano bench, maybe the best MC in the history of gospel music, Hovey Lister.
I wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The path of sin, too long I've trod. Now I'm coming home. Coming.
Captivate a crowd right there on the seat of that piano, and he could preach, he could sing, he could write, he could arrange, whatever Hovey wanted to do, Hovey could do, and he's my mentor and still my friend. I've got a picture of him in my office. Number three, it's the only person that's really active, well, Swaggart's active, but that's active in the gospel music community, number three, and I give her number three because she's changed the industry. She's the only piano player I've ever seen that carried her own piano around from state to state and place to place, and that's Kim Collinsworth. Okay.
Yeah.
Number two, Wallace B. Wally Filer, without a shadow of a doubt.
Mm-hmm.
And then number one, and Arthur, I'm going to let you comment on this later in this when you give your tops, because you knew him personally. And you could not ever build a Mount Rushmore of musicians, pianists, without the great Anthony Berger. And when I looked down and I did the research on Anthony, and I realized he was only 44 years old when he passed, and I'm sitting here at 49 today, I realized what a loss we suffered as far as being gospel music fans with Anthony. But that's my top five. Anthony, Wally, Kim, Hovey, and Jimmy Swaggart. What do y'all think about that?
That's good.
Now, let me tell you this. There's one quartet out there that played six songs, and if they would have been quartets the whole time, he may have been the greatest gospel music piano player of all time. Any idea who I'm talking about?
Nope.
If you go back and you look up Million Dollar Quartet and you listen to the gospel music of Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Pickens, Johnny Cash, and Elvis Presley, and you watch Jerry Lee play songs like I'll Fly Away, he had the flair of Anthony, he had the touch of Wally, he had the instrumentation of Kim Collinsworth, he had the MC ability of Hovey, and he could probably preach as good as Jimmy if he wanted to. He had all five of those rolled up into one. I want to play him play. I want to play him playing the piano real quick before we come back. Here's the Million Dollar Quartet with our friend Jerry Lee Lewis, Johnny Cash, and Carl Perkins, SGNP.
I said some sad morning when this life is over, brother, I'll fly away.
Music show, and I throw Jerry Lee Lewis, Johnny Cash, Carl Perkins, and Elvis Presley in there?
No, sir.
Could they not have been the best gospel quartet of all time?
Yeah.
You know what they
all... Yeah, I don't know, but...
Here's what I know. Here's what I know about the guys. they all had a rich heritage in their life of gospel music, all of them. And we could go on with that forever. I mean, I was reading earlier today, you know, Swaggart and Jerry Lee Lewis and Mickey Gilley are all first cousins. Did you know that?
Yeah.
So anyway, they had to come from a musical family. Do a great job. All right, Arthur, it's your turn. Your top five.
Okay, my top five.
Yes, sir.
From Boston. And I did like you. I picked players that I thought brought something different than your normal players when they came along. And so from my five up is Nick Bruno.
Yeah.
And I kind of mentioned this with Jeff. When he came along, his stuff, even playing for the Kingsmen, you know, three chords and a cloud of dust, he played chords that weren't predictable. And that was unique at that time when he came along. And that's the reason I picked him. Josh Singletary. Great player, great entertainer. He's just very phenomenal player.
Yeah.
And of course, Anthony Berger. Anthony was probably, and probably you're exactly right. You can't have a Mount Rushmore without him in there, because he changed everything when he came on playing. He not only was he a great player, he was a great stageman. He just, you couldn't stump him. I mean, I don't think there was ever a song that, well, I know there wasn't the whole time I was there, because Hamill would try to do it. He would call out, you know, get people to call out songs in the audience to try to stump him on something that he wouldn't know how to play. And I'm telling you, I've never seen him stumped. I mean, he would play stuff that you couldn't even, you wouldn't think, well, that doesn't even compute that he would even know that song. And he would play it, and or at least enough to where you knew what it was.
Arthur, let me ask you a question about Anthony real quick.
Yeah.
Outside of the studio, did you ever see him use a piece of sheet music on stage? Because in every Gaither video, every Kingsman concert, every trio concert that I ever saw or I've saw on video, I've never seen a piece of sheet music in front of the man.
No, in fact, that was probably one of his Achilles heels when he started working in the studio, because he wasn't a studio player until later, you know, probably late, you know, mid-80s on out, he started kind of playing studio work, and that was kind of... that was probably his weakness, was he had to teach himself how to it wasn't that he couldn't read them, it's just he'd play through the song one time and he knew it, and if it changed, or if they changed the chart a little bit, then he had to go back and relearn it. So it was a little bit of a learning curve for him, during, if you believe that or not.
So it's safe to say he hated click tracks.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And most live players do. Live players hate click tracks, because and that's part of playing live, is being able to move this way or that way in the song. And if it needs to go up, or if the tempo needs to slide a little bit, or, you know, that's part of playing live. And it's difficult for live players to transition to the studio. That's the reason you don't see that many of them that do both at the same time. You may see them transition from one to the other, but most of the time they don't do both at the same time, because it's very difficult. It's really hard to make yourself, discipline yourself to play with that click.
All right.
And not get into the music.
Your last two.
Hobie Lister. Same reason you he was best at all of it. And great player. and I had the privilege to play with him about a year there, and some, and man, just he was just a great player.
Good.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah. And my number one is Tim Parton, without a doubt, probably the best player I've ever heard. Can play any style and play it well, and just a great player.
Jeff, that segues good to you, because Tim played with the Lesters up there out of St. Louis, out of your area for a while, I believe. And
yeah, I remember he was just a kid when he started.
Yeah.
Yep. Tim was good. All right, Jeff, we've built it up all week long. Number five for you, who is it?
Well, Jeff Stice would be my number five. You know, the first time I heard him, he was playing for the Monitors Quartet in the early 80s. And then naturally went on with the Neelands and the
Hey, who was his bass singer, by the way, with that group?
London Paris. London Paris, yeah.
We've got Jeff coming up in just a second after the break. He's going to be our special guest. But we didn't set that up, I promise you. Number four, who you got, Jeff?
Danny Coker, the original pianist for the Cathedral Quartet. Not only could, you know, we're talking about playing, but the man also sung baritone at the same time, and to be able to play like he did and to sing also at the same time. And I heard George Young say one time that he never heard or saw Danny Coker practice at all. So that's amazing. You know,
number
he also
three.
Played the accordion. Anthony Berger.
Wow.
And, you know, we've discussed him, but the thing I remember about Anthony was he could take a song like When We All Get to Heaven and play it in like 10 different styles.
Number two.
Number two would be Jackie Marshall, who was a pianist for the Blackwood Brothers through most of the decade of the 50s. And he could also play any style like Anthony did.
Yeah.
Number one,
the guy that took Jackie Marshall's place, Wally Varner.
Yeah, I knew you were going there. Why Wally number one?
Well, you know, it's been said that, I've heard JD say this a lot, and James, that when Wally played, it sounded like a whole band. You know, they didn't need a band because Wally made it sound like a band. So,
yeah.
And, you know, there's a fine line in accompanying the group and standing out. And, you know, when it came time to stand out, he could do that. You could also accompany the group well, so.
Yeah.
That'd be my number one.
Guys, you know, we've named some great pianists. We've missed some, okay? Here's some names I want to just throw out there at the end of the show, and you folks make some quick comments. Stan Whitmire.
Oh, yeah.
He's fantastic.
Gary Jones.
Yep.
Taco, yeah.
Andrew Ishii.
Yeah.
Yep.
Here's one that don't get the credit for playing a piano, but he's probably a better pianist than he is anything, our good friend Tim Loveless.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Didn't even know he played piano.
Yeah.
How about this right here? I call him the first guy to build a brand in gospel music, being an advertising guy. You got anybody know who I'm talking about? Daryl Stewart.
He's one of my favorites.
With the Red Sox. Where he started and is where he's going to finish, you know, on the piano stool.
Yeah. I've always loved his style, you know. Yeah.
How about this one, Arthur? How about this one, Jeff? The Man from the Mountains, Martin Cook.
Martin Cook.
We can't forget the ladies, okay? Eva Mae Lefevre.
I've been walking with Jesus all the time. We're walking and talking as we climb. We're traveling the road to the sky.
Rose Nell Spear, you know?
Yeah.
Who was the guy? And I can't find this guy's name anywhere. Arthur, you may know it. Jeff, you may know it because he's from up there in the Missouri area. He was the pianist for the Magruders.
Oh, Denny Autry.
There you go.
Yes. Yeah, he could burn it up.
He could burn it. Man, those are some great guys. Anybody that did you guys feel like we need to name that maybe I forgot here? Henry Slaughter. We didn't throw that one out there, I don't think.
Oh, yeah. Well, here's one from the 60s that people down your way would know, Darien, that she played with the Georgians Quartet. Her name was Trudy McNabb. And a lot of diehard quartet people from back then in the 60s remember her.
I don't.
Tear it up, too.
I have no idea who Trudy McNabb is, but I will go check her out from this point forward.
How about Tracy Phillips?
Tracy Phillips? And her mother, Eloise, one of the greatest organists.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no doubt. Yep. No doubt. Mm-hmm. Arthur, have we missed anybody that you can think of?
Oh, man. I mean, you could just name them off. And great players, you get into studio players, you know, there's great players.
Gary Prim.
You know, Hanson's birthed a lot of great players, studio players. You know, through the years, I tell you, a player that a lot of people never really gave credit for was Rodney Lachaume, that played with the Hensons at the end.
Yep,
Rodney passed away here a few years ago. Rodney was a great player, and he just kind of got overshadowed by all the other players in the band, but he was a great piano player.
Jeff, we appreciate your time, my man. Did I forget anybody? I mean, was I off base and throwing? Was I off base and throwing Jerry Lee Lewis in there? Would he not have made a great gospel music piano player?
I don't know why not.
Arthur, what do you think? Could Jerry Lee play gospel music, you think?
Well, you know, if you research his life in read anything about him, he really struggled with that whole thing of church and rock and roll and it was always a struggle for him because of his raising and I believe that Jerry had a calling on his life to probably be in ministry, but he rebelled against it and would not submit to it. Think of the people that he could have reached, if he had heeded to that call. But you know, like us all, we kind of rebel at times.
I interviewed Mickey Gilley one time, and I asked him who was the most talented out of all three of you, Jerry, Jimmy, or you, and he said Jimmy without a doubt. Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. Jeff, I appreciate it, my friend. Thank you.
Thank you. And if we left out anybody's favorite, forgive us.
Yeah, yeah. We tried. Yeah. We tried. Harold Timmons, don't pick on us too bad, all righty?
Good being on the show with you, Jeff.
You heard him playing Soon and Very Soon off his Daywind project as we were coming in. Jeff Stice is with us. Jeff, how are you doing, my friend?
I am doing fantastic. How are you guys?
You know what? Arthur's got it made because he just got in off the bus, but he's turned back into a real quartet. I kid about this. He's back to being a real quartet man, Jeff, because he's having to travel, you know, these weekends. And, you know, you fought that fight for a while, playing with the Kingdom Heirs, then having to hit the road half the year. So Arthur's at it. So he's in a change of season, so we can pick on him today. What do you think?
Well, it was Arthur, is it still just 3 months that you travel?
Actually, it's less than that now. We're only doing about, well, this year we're only doing about 7 weeks. So, yeah, so we
good
got five more to go. Hallelujah.
All right.
There you go.
Ain't nothing wrong with that. No.
Jeff, tell the world what you're up to these days.
Well, I'm currently in a solo career. I'll go ahead and call it a ministry. I don't know that I've ever been able to really do that up until the last little bit. I'm finding as I get older, I'm becoming more and more aware of who I am and who my Heavenly Father is. And to be honest, I'm becoming more aware of whose I am, and that's my Heavenly Father's. And so it is. It's a solo ministry, and I travel across the United States playing my piano solos and sharing a little bit. There's an occasional weekend where I'll jump on the bus with the Neelands and go out and play for them. But for the most part, I'm on my own and doing some session work.
Jeff, I know before when we had talked before, you gave us a brief outline of how you got started in gospel music. Tell the world out there how Jeff Stice became a piano player and what drove you to be in this art form and this ministry of Southern gospel.
Well, when I was a child, my dad was stationed at Tyndall Air Force Base in Panama City, Florida. And he and mom had started finding, there used to be a grocery store in that area called Pleasing's Market. And every once in a while, J.G. Whitfield would set up a big wagon, and he would have gospel groups come in. And I kind of spent the first 4 years of my life, and I know it's only four, but going to those gospel concerts on that flatbed wagon trailer, you know. And I always watched the piano player. So when Daddy got out of service and we moved to Louisville, Kentucky, we would go to the Memorial Auditorium, downtown Louisville. And I remember seeing Tarzan, Tony Brown, that played for the Stamps the first time. Mm-hmm. And sitting there, and I loved how J.D. would interact with him, pick on him a little bit, and how he'd sit there and smile. And then I saw Hovey with the Statesman Quartet, and Wally Varner with the Blackwood Brothers, and even May Lefevre. And I took to the piano players. I wanted to be a piano player growing up. And they got me piano lessons, and started playing for my dad's group. As they say, the rest of it is just that's how my story was written.
That's how you started up there in Kentucky, and you just keep on today. Who was the first group you played for professionally?
Professionally, where I got paid every week.
Where you got paid? I'm sure there was somebody. You can tell us how you got to that professional point, but tell us how that occurred.
I actually was playing for a group called the Monitors. London Paris was the bass singer in it.
Yeah.
And we sang with the Rex Neyland singers one night in Macon, Georgia. And it just so happened that Ray Fisher, who was Rex's piano player at the time, he had just turned his notice in. And they let me play a piano solo that night. It was when they rang those golden bells. I'll never forget that. And Rex came up to me after it was over with and told me I did a good job. Of course, that made my night.
You know? Yeah.
And went on home and never saw anything else about it. But I got a call a couple of weeks later, and Rex was on the other line. And you have to understand, I sat with their records on my piano. I had a record player that sat on top of my piano, and I would sit and stare at that album cover, learning their songs, wanting it so bad. Sometimes I would play too hard, and the needle would jump, you know. And for those listeners who don't know what a record is, it's this big round thing with a hole in the middle. And I remember getting a phone call from him, and him saying, Jeff Stice, and I said, yes, and he said, this is Rex Neyland. Well, I was speechless. I don't even know how he got my number. But he said, I got a problem. I said, what? And he said, well, my piano player is going to be out of town, and we're going to be singing at the Joyful Noise Thursday night. I wonder, would it be possible for you to maybe come down and play for us? And I said, absolutely, you know. And I went down there and didn't rehearse at all with them because I knew their songs. I knew the keys. They were pretty easy on me, you know. They
now,
sung
now,
their old...
Now, Jeff, let me stop you there. Who was with Rex Neyland at the time? Was it Rodney? Was it Kelly? Was it Janet?
Yeah,
That was the group. Okay.
Yeah, Rodney, Kelly, Jerry, Karen,
mm-hmm.
and, of course, Rex. The band was Todd. Vernon Lee played mm-hmm. drums, and Bill Jones played guitar and steel
right.
guitar.
Okay.
And so I played for him at the Joyful Noise that afternoon. And then a couple weeks later, he offered me a job at the National Quartet Convention.
Fun.
And I'll never forget that as long as I live. I miss Rex.
Yeah. Rex is a great man. Great man. From my home, he lived right here in my hometown. He's not from my hometown, but Smyrna, Georgia. You spent a lot of time here, no doubt, catching the bus, Jeff. What you got, Arthur?
Well, I remember, you know, when Jeff started with the Neylands, and to be honest with you, I thought it really brought the band level up. I mean, it was just like they just gelled. And Jeff did such a great job with them, and his energy level, I think, and that, to me, that's what makes a great live player. It's not just the fact that they sit there and play, but the energy level that they, you know, they look like they really enjoy what they're doing, and they get into the music and into the songs, and that's what makes them a great player.
Jeff,
you are very kind, Arthur.
Arthur.
Well, I mean that. I really mean that. And, you know, that was back, you know, that was the age of the bands when you came along. I mean, that was, you know, everybody had a band and it just, you guys just cooked. I mean, you guys really cooked, did a great job.
Jeff, we've been talking today about great piano players throughout the history of gospel music. And your names came up earlier in the show when we were talking. Who are some of the ones that you look at and look up to that are some of the greatest of all time, and why?
Well, like I said, growing up, I fell in love with Hovey and Wally Varner and even Mae Lefebvre. Then I started noticing a different style of playing that wasn't necessarily as showy. You might say, for lack of a better way to say it, Tommy Fairchild.
Yeah.
He was just fabulous. He was a great arranger. Tony Brown, Tarzan,
mm-hmm.
His chords and stuff that he would use. I started listening to the Goss Brothers.
Larry.
And Larry was amazing. What a great player he was.
Yeah.
And, of course, after I got into it with Rex, I had the opportunity to meet Anthony and then Roger Bennett. And there was only one Anthony Berger.
Right.
And he just was kind of the standard that everybody began to be measured with. He was not only a wonderful showman, but what a great technician on the piano. And he knew what people liked, and Hamill knew what people liked.
Yeah.
And he did. And, of course, I had the opportunity to become good friends with him, became real close friends with Roger. I played at his funeral. That was kind of tough.
Yeah.
The three of us, we kind of came in together, and then Gary Jones popped into the picture. Great player.
Yeah. And I do in no way want to ruffle feathers. I love praise and worship music. I really do.
Yeah.
Not to take away from the showmanship thing or the showy stuff, I've started to
of the church. The church was built on
study more chord work and that kind of thing. Of course, then we start talking to Larry Goff, David Foster in the secular world.
No, I am not
huge fan. Yes. I love Randy Waldman.
That
Randy Waldman is a brilliant pianist, but occasionally David Foster will use him on the recording.
People's lives.
Matt Rawlings.
The music that is.
Oh my!
Part of this
there are
music
so many
just,
that I can just sit
and
go. Oh, I wish I could play like that person.
Love
Gordon playing.
Three chords in the ballad. Yeah.
He's an amazing player. You know, the Kingdom Mayors have got a great little player now. Andy, he's fantastic
today, and Arthur will.
A lot of talented guys out there.
Arthur himself. There are so many songs you know where they're going. Before they ever get there, chord line.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that they're not beautiful songs. I would know what to say. I'm saying that.
I'm going to do this. We play this game from time to time. But first, we're going to pause for a moment. And we're going to play a clip of you playing with the great Wally Varner at the Grand Ole Gospel.
But, Jeff, I know we got to get out of here.
I appreciate your
time, my friend. I'll say
this
in response to what you just said about
him. What was happening there.
My great uncle said this one time, and he was church treasurer.
And, Wally.
He said, if I had a kid, I'd make him take piano.
What happened?
I said, Uncle Edward.
Charlie,
he said because he'd
he knew that I loved
Wally
playing.
Of his life.
Eva May playing. And, I remember when I was at Perfect Heart, we got invited
and
to be a part of
I'm
the Grand Ole Gospel
that,
reunion.
Jeff, how can people
in Greenville,
find
South Carolina.
Out more about Jeff
and,
Stice?
We got through with our set, and I started off stage,
and
Charlie
and
called me back
stuff,
on stage.
Where you headed
he said, now, you know, you've got some heroes that are part of this weekend. He said, one in particular that will be here tomorrow. Or however you word it, Mr. Wally Varner. He said, sit down there and play me something like Wally.
You know, I'm on Facebook.
And I sat down and I started playing this introduction that Wally kind of made famous. And by the time I got to the end of the introduction, out he walked. And that was very, very cool. That was the first time that he and I had ever done anything together. I had met him once before, years earlier, when I played for the Blackwood Brothers. But I'm telling you, man, that was a big deal to me
Becky
that night. And he was so nice to me. I grew up knowing him and getting to know Polly's wife. And
if you ever need
had the honor of getting to play a song on his behalf when he was inducted into the Hall of Fame. I played Bell of Joy, keep ringing.
In the garage.
And he was just a brilliant player. That was before band. He had to be the band.
Let's take a break real quick, Jeff. Let's hear you and Wally playing a duet.
Thank you, my friend. Jeff, it's always a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for being so receptive to us here on SGNP and help promote us and all that fun stuff, my friend. Thank you, buddy.
Well, I love you a bunch. I appreciate all you're doing for Southern Gospel Music.
Thank you, Jeff.
Love you too, Arthur. Love you too, buddy.
All right, man.
Jeff Stice on SGNP. Arthur, we're going to close it out real quick. But, Arthur, let me ask you one quick question. I ask you this every week. We're going to let Jeff take us out with one of the greatest songs ever music composing ever wrote. What's wrong with living right anyway? Here we are, Jeff Stice with Hallelujah Chorus on SGNP. Varner, Jeff Stice playing together there at the Grand Ole Gospel Reunion. Got to ask you a question, Jeff, about Wally. And I noticed this when I saw the videos of Wally, even when I looked at some of his Gaither mentions, and he was on a ton of the Gaither tapes playing there. He always seemed to have heavy jewelry on his fingers, yet it didn't impede his playing whatsoever. Am I just noticing something, or was that a tendency that he had when you noticed, or do you even recall?
Well, you know, the whole ring thing was started by Liberace.
Right.
And, yeah, having rings on all of his fingers. And then piano players, every once in a while, they'd have one on their little finger.
Right.
Their pinky. And, I don't know. I've got one that I wear. That Randall McDaniel. He's a jeweler from out in down in Florida. He made me, and it does take some getting used to. I'll say that, you know, because when I play, I don't know. I have a tendency to bang it against the key, and I've had to learn to lift my fingers up. So in a way, I guess it kind of helped my technique. But yeah, I always thought it was cool. His rings. That was neat.
And I mean, he had a bunch of rings. Did you ever notice that, Arthur? I mean, he had a bunch of rings. It would just look to me, and I'm not a pianist at all. I can play one-handed and make it sound poor. But anyway, but it would always seem to me that somebody with a lot of rings on their finger, it'd make it harder for him to play. But Wally was no slouch. I mean, he wasn't a little fella either. And, I mean, he could just tear it up. Didn't have the longest arms in the world either, but could just tear it up just in everything I've seen. I mean, I didn't know if I was saying something inappropriate, but, I mean, it was kind of neat is what I thought. So,
he was great.
Great.
Hey, Arthur didn't Anthony wear a pinky ring?
He did. He did.
I thought he did.
He tried wearing a couple of. He had another one that he wore on his right hand, I believe it was, and it kept getting in his way. So he kind of quit wearing that one. His right hand was just so fast, man.
I actually have the one that I've got. Randall made. It's in the shape of a piano, and when he first made it for me, it would turn. While I played, and I took it back to him, and I said, I don't know what the... And so he put a weight on the opposite side and molded it into the ring part, and now it kind of stays in place. But I don't know. I guess that's just being a showy thing. I don't know.
Jeff, I'm going to run down a few names. I want you to say the first thing that comes to your mind. But first, I want folks to hear you play a great tune. We'll play a little clip of this. Here's Jeff Stice with Through It All on SGNP. Jeff playing Through It All on his Daywind tape there, and you can check Jeff out. Jeff will give you his information on where you can find all his product and all that at the end of this interview. But Jeff, I said before we left, we've talked a little bit about Anthony, we've talked a little bit about Wally Varner. I'm going to mention some other piano players' names, and if you've noticed on social media this week, because I've noticed you chimed in also, when your good friend Becky Simmons says, y'all ain't mentioned Jeff. Well, I think somebody has. And you said, I love you, Becky, in the post. You know what I'm talking about. There's been a ton of piano players mentioned. I want you, when I mention these piano players, I want you to tell me what you think. And I tell you what, let's go back and forth. I'm going to pick one, and then I'm going to let Arthur pick. Well, no. I'm just going to let Jeff do this right now. Is that okay, Arthur?
Sure.
Arthur, you pick one, too. You be thinking of a couple of wine, name a couple, all righty? Jeff, first one. I think right now she's probably the first lady of gospel music piano players, and you know who I'm talking to about when I say that, Kim Collingsworth. What's your thoughts on Kim?
Kim Collingsworth. Anointed. She plays with a lot of authority. She's wonderful. Wonderful. Good friend. She's a really good friend of mine.
And the fact that she can carry... Does the fact she gets to carry her own piano around make it easier on her, you think?
Absolutely. as a piano player, I've played on pianos that some have told me it was brought over on the Mayflower.
Yeah.
I've played on some that I guarantee you were drugged by the Mayflower. it's like a microphone. If you get used to a microphone, you're going to do better. And you get used to a certain feel on a piano, it's absolutely easier. That does not take away from her playing.
Oh,
she's
no.
She's tremendous.
Tremendous. One of the tops of all time. Do you think it makes a difference for piano players today, for the piano players of the 40s, the 30s, 40s, and 50s who grew up on those hard, upright pianos and had a hard sound compared to guys that come up today and learn a lot of times on baby grands or even keyboards, and the touch is a little bit different. Do you think the guys of old had a different style because of that, and it sometimes made them more flashy, for lack of a better word, because they had to play so hard compared to now?
Possibly. I don't like an electric keyboard. I just don't like it.
Yeah.
I think a grand piano looks better on stage. I think it dresses up the stage. I think there's a class about it that a keyboard, even though it may sound better, in some cases where it's not going to go out of tune, I have found, and I think Arthur might agree with me on this, live performances, I think the majority of the people are there, they're watching you more than they're hearing you. I think they're listening, don't get me wrong, but I think that you can get away with a lot of things in a live performance because they're watching and they're looking, and I just think a grand just gives it more of a professional look. I don't know. That's just my thoughts on the whole thing. So, yeah, there is definitely a difference in how you learn to play based on a keyboard as opposed to an acoustic piano.
Here's a name for you. Here's a name for you. Arthur, be ready for yours here in just a second.
Yeah.
Jackie Marshall.
The first one. He was the first flashy guy. I know a lot of people compared Anthony to Jack Marshall.
Yeah.
But you go back and listen to his left hand, how heavy it was, those rolling tenths that he did in the left hand, and all of his quick right hand, it was slick right hand. He was the first one, the first showy.
Arthur?
Tim Parton.
Tim Parton. Tim Parton technically is as good as I've ever heard.
Yeah.
He doesn't have a lot of showmanship. And teach his own, but to sit and listen to him play, he I don't know, he has a style that is just very cool. It sounds, it really comes across good in a studio. Fantastic.
Nick Bruno.
Nick Bruno. Oh, wow. The original guy that I started listening to a lot with the Kingsman stuff. He had that quartet thing going on. I love Nick's playing. He's a great studio player too.
Yeah.
Great studio player.
He had some unique chords, you know, that
he did. Oh my goodness. Great.
Came along at the, you know, it was a you know, it was just really cool, some of the stuff that he played when he came along.
Yeah, color chords, you know. First time you'd start hearing the real cool stuff. Yeah, yes. I agree with that.
You mentioned Gordon Mote earlier. How hard is it, and I know we can never be Gordon Mote because we're not blind, but how hard is it for folks like Gordon Mote, Ray Charles, Ronnie Millsap, and the great Pig Robbins, how hard is it, do you think, for those guys? Or how easy is it for those guys, Jeff? Have you ever had a conversation with one of them about that?
No. I can give you my thoughts.
Yeah.
I think, and I'm talking about me.
Yeah.
And only me. I think they have probably been times in their lives when they haven't felt good about the fact that they couldn't see. But I'm not sure that they weren't able to see more because they were blind. I think sometimes there are so many distractions today, and to set and play, you're looking at things. I'm looking to see how my hand looks now, you know, and these are just things that cross your mind, your posture.
To focus only on the music.
They were seeing the melodies in their head, and they were seeing these things take shape in their mind. And like I said, I'm not so sure that they didn't see more than I do when I sit down to play. Brilliant. Gordon Mote, he has his style, and it is his style because he's the only one that can do that kind of stuff. A lot of people can get close, but the rascal can play. Oh, my goodness gracious.
You know, it's almost like, and I've seen the movie, and I'm sure you have too, Ray, and then you hear folks like Pig Robbins' story, and the folks that don't know Pig, he was a great Nashville player, probably did the best piano introduction for a country song that it with Charlie Rich behind closed doors. When you hear that little twang, dun 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 dun, we'll play that in just a second. But when you hear that kind of stuff, it's like you said, they saw stuff that we can't see, and it just jingled. Last name I'll mention, you mentioned him earlier, and you said you played at his funeral, Roger Bennett.
Roger had a unique style. There was nothing flashy about it. He was a classy way of playing, quartet guy. I miss Roger. I miss him bad.
Yeah.
Good friend.
Jeff, most underrated piano player that you've ever seen. And it could be a guy that's on stage or a guy nobody's never heard or a lady nobody's never heard that you met at a church somewhere. Somebody that you maybe they're a studio person. Who knows?
Now, when you say underrated, I think that's a relative term.
Yeah.
Are you talking about popularity-wise?
Yeah, that people just don't know. Who's out there that people just have never heard of? Maybe it's a gentleman you met in a church 25 years ago. Maybe it's somebody that's in a studio right now that's a great studio pianist. But when I think of people like that, and I don't mean to downplay people like this, but I look at like Tracy Phillips and her mom Eloise Phillips, and I think about people like that. They've heard of them, but yet if you're in the industry, but the general public may not have heard of them.
As far as general public goes, of course, this guy that I'm going to tell you, he's well known in his circle. Of friends in the studio world. I think David Hunsinger is incredible.
Yeah.
Some of the color chords that he can lay down and his take on music in general, he just amazes me. He really does.
Fun. Arthur, who you got? Who's somebody that you can think back over time and say, wow, somebody like that that's pianist?
Oh, wow. There's a bunch, you know, and that's the thing. There's so many great church pianists. I think through one of the guys that I grew up listening to play was a guy by the name of Bobby Spivey, and he was very popular in the area, in the Asheville area. But nobody probably ever heard of him outside of that, really. But, boy, he's probably one of the best players I have ever heard. I mean, just a great player. He was one of those – his all of his chords were musical. And I mean that by you could – it was different. And, Jeff, you know what that means. It's just different than everybody else was playing.
Yeah, I love Ellen Marsh, too. She's a wonderful pianist, a lady from out in, I think she lives in Arkansas, but what a brilliant player she is.
Jeff, are we losing the value of church pianist and organist this day and time?
Yes. And I do in no way want to ruffle feathers here.
Yeah.
I love praise and worship music. I really do.
Yeah.
But I think that if you listen to the hymns of the church that the church was built on, thought went into that. Mm-hmm. Am I saying that no thought goes into praise and worship music? No, I am not saying that. I'm saying that these songs were written through experiential times in people's lives. The music that is part of this music, it's just, I don't know, it's just creative. It's not, as they used to say, three chords and a cloud of dust, you know. It's not predictable. There are so many songs today, and Arthur will back me up on this, I know, because Arthur himself is a wonderful musician. There are so many songs you know where they're going before they ever get there, chord wise, musically. Yeah. And I'm not saying that they're not beautiful songs. I'm in no way saying that. I'm saying that in addition to these praise and worship songs, I think that the hymn is being pushed aside, and they're works of art. They are truly works of art.
Well, Jeff, I know we got to get out of here. I appreciate your time, my friend. I'll say this in response to what you just said about the hymns. My great uncle said this one time, and he was church treasurer. He said, if I had a kid, I'd make him take piano lessons. I said, Uncle Edward, why is that? He said, because he'd always get paid to come to church for the rest of his life. So I'm kidding. And you got to go anyway. I'm kidding about that. But, Jeff, how can people find out more about Jeff Stice and your music and your schedule and all that kind of good stuff? And where are you headed this weekend, Super Bowl weekend, or you get to sit at the house?
I'm staying at the house. That's one of the perks of getting to do what I'm doing now. I've got a thumb on my schedule. It's a pretty strong thumb. I'm on Facebook. Jeff Stice. I've got two Facebook pages. I have one in the musician band thing, and then my own personal page, Jeff Stice. There's a picture of me and Stacy on both of them, so you'll know it's me. My website is Jeff Stice Music. My schedule is on my website. As far as booking, I'm with the Dominion Agency. Becky Simmons has helped me out, and she's awesome. But I'm not hard to find. And if you ever need a piano concert in the area, Christmas banquet, Valentine's Day banquet, Veterans Day, hey, I am huge in the garage sale world. So you just give me a call, and I'll come and play a little music for you and share a little bit about my life.
Thank you, my friend. Jeff, it's always a pleasure to talk to you, and thank you for being so receptive to us here on SGNP and help promote us and all that fun stuff, my friend. Thank you, buddy.
Well, I love you a bunch. I appreciate all you're doing for Southern Gospel music.
Thank you, Jeff.
I love you too, Arthur. Love you too, buddy.
All right, man. Jeff Stice on SGNP. Arthur, we're going to close it out real quick. But, Arthur, let me ask you one quick question. I ask you this every week, and we're going to let Jeff take us out with one of the greatest songs ever, music composing ever wrote. I'm messing it up. What's wrong with living right anyway, Arthur?
Not a thing.
Here we are, Jeff Stice with Hallelujah Chorus on SGNP.
Thank you for listening to SGNP. If you're listening on radio, please note you can listen to our podcast 24/7 on your own schedule. Just download wherever you get your podcasts from or visit us online at southerngospelnewspodcast.com. To hear it on your smart speaker, just ask Alexa or Google to play Southern Gospel News Podcast. And after listening, please leave a remark in the remarks section and subscribe, and you'll receive our program free every Friday. And remember to check out Southern Gospel News Podcast social media for daily fun and giveaways. We're the audible voice of gospel music. We look to uplift you every week. SGNP, where it's all about the gospel.